student's body to organize a demographic study of its own self. For that, I must congratulate you. I really don't know of any other institution in this country which has done something like this. Most institutions are very reluctant to do this. And I noticed that you also have, you are the director of the institution writing the foreword to your report, which is also quite a nice thing. Much of what I want to talk about is about the way we think of how the powerful respond, how the powerful deal with caste and with many other kinds of inequalities, and particularly in educational institutions. One of the things which several of you have been talking about has been the way this issue comes up again and again. Do I deserve to be here? Was it correct for me to be brought here? This issue is coming up again and again. And I want to suggest that this is a question which should be taken up seriously. For which I want to talk a little bit about the background, some background issues, which might help us to address this question. Who deserves to be in an institute of higher education? What does it mean to deserve to be in an institute of higher education? So the story is actually about something called a meritocracy. This very idea that somebody deserves to be at a place because of, by virtue of what that individual is a very new idea in human history. It's been there at many points at different places, but if you see complex societies, societies which have different strata in them, this idea that it's only my individual hard work which is important is a relatively new idea. We know that if you see this region or any part of large complex societies, around 200 years ago, mostly people became what can be the equivalent of lawyers, maybe courtiers, people who intervened with the state. How did you become that? One didn't become it by an entrance test. One became a courtier by virtue of one's community, by virtue of where is one born, what kind of social networks one has. That's how it usually was done. This shift into the idea that you can have an open entrance system is a relatively new thing. And it's coming out of several kinds of ideas. One of the idea being coming out of modernity, and the idea that it is what I am now, what I do today, that matters, not one's birth. Actually, the idea of merit and meritocracy is perhaps a very strong argument in favor of freedom, in favor of individual freedom, that individuals matter, the communities don't matter. And which is why we see this shift in the nature of institutions, in the way admissions are done for education, in the way recruitments are done for organizations, which has been gradually moving away. It's not a clear movement, there are all kinds of ups and downs. But the idea that we look at people's achievements is crucial. In terms of education as large-scale systems, we find examples of this kind of thing in China, when the Chinese bureaucracy, for example, gets set up. We also find that the first large-scale education system with a formal acceptance of meritocracy is actually coming up after the French Revolution in France. And the French Revolution, of course, is famous for physically violently throwing out the old elite. Very interestingly, therefore, the idea of merit and meritocracy is a statement against older forms of privilege. It's a statement against older inherited privileges. Now, we'll come back to how this works in practice. But for that, let's look at some basic ideas. So a basic notion here is that for admission to an institution, for recruitment or for promotions, we look at an individual's achievement, an individual's hard work, and what the individual is doing. This is very different from how people talk about reservations, for instance, nowadays, and we keep forgetting that India has always had reservations. because usually they give reservations for the privileged. What's interesting about these reservations is they are a reversal of. And this is a very interesting. I should say always, India has had a complex history. But for a very large part of time and of the last 2000 years, in many parts, there have been sharp restrictions on who can do what. Reservations on the basis of jati, on the basis of region, on the basis of religion, on the basis very prominently of gender. You know, all of those. Now, how does this new idea come up? That we get rid of these ideas, we get rid of these processes. It's a mixture of political, cultural, even religious processes which is shaping this. So this notion of an open society becomes a very important thing, where the idea is that people can become whatever they want or whatever they are good at, irrespective of their family origin, irrespective of the social networks they are part of. It's a very, very important idea. But there are problems in its both in its application, and both, I would also suggest, in its conceptualization. So let's call this the older view of meritocracy, an older view of meritocracy, which is a notion of the individual, and the individual free from all social encumbrances. See, one basic problem is, as all of us know, my achievement is not my individualism. Let's face it. It's very interesting thing that people say that I worked hard, therefore I deserve something, but that's really an ideological statement. Of course, I am there, and I am distinct from society, but my achievement is a mix of me, the individual, and the society I'm part of. I often point out to my students that I am the fifth generation to have studied at Punjab University in its various branches. So how much of what I am doing is mine? How much of it is all those generations on whose shoulders I stand? So here is a basic problem. When we say that individual achievement should be rewarded, the problem is that mostly achievement is not completely individual. It's only a partly individual thing. And our ability to understand the others part is crucial for rethinking what a meritocracy should be. There are many kinds of sociological factors, political processes which shape our achievement. Caste is one of them. There's another question we at some point I must talk about. What one means by caste is a surprisingly complex thing, but that's another longer story. There are many kinds of these processes. There are also another kind of problems, set of problems in meritocracy. Meritocracy can be very status quoist. For example, what is the best kind of police officer of the Hyderabad kind that we want? So the ideal police officer there would be one who accepts the power structure and works for that. Now, do we want, is this a meritocracy? If we are selecting people who are like this and taking the job, is this a meritocracy? A common problem one is many teachers have pointed out that students who are very highly achievement oriented usually are very reluctant to question the nature of the knowledge which they are studying. Who are the students who score highest? The students who don't question what they are doing, what they are being told to do, will find it easier to score. I'm not sure if that's only by this school life. But that is one of our problems. If I argue with what I'm supposed to study. You know, I will spend a lot of time and energy on that, and I will not prepare enough for the exam. This is one of the problems. I'm not saying that all knowledge is useless, I'm not trying to argue that, but I'm pointing out that in the notion of merit, the status quo is an important parameter which you have to look at. Are we testing for merit on the right criteria? Maybe we are, maybe we are not, but that's another of the problems of the meritocracy. What is the system for which we are selecting? Is that right? When we struggle against caste, when we struggle against other forms of social inequality and injustice, there's often a temptation to reject the idea of merit and to reject the idea of a meritocracy. I would argue against that. I would argue that we need to rethink merit, and it's important to rethink merit and meritocracy, in which, among other things, we problematize what is merit, the content of merit. What are we really testing for? What makes a good lawyer? Who is a good lawyer? Is a good lawyer a person who will work for the highest salary for anything? Is that a good lawyer? Is a good lawyer a person who works for the poor? Is that a good lawyer? How do you test for that? How do you select for that? What are the entrance systems which will filter in whatever you think is a good lawyer? That is part of the question of merit. Merit for what? What kind of merit? These become important questions. And the second kind of redefinitions, there will be several things, when we try to restore and recover the idea of merit and the meritocracy, is to start acknowledging that achievement is not only an individual act. Now, that has many kinds of implications, where we start to build the community and the social dimension of human action and human existence into our understanding of action, into our understanding of achievement, has many interesting implications. One thing which it means is we try to get a more sophisticated understanding of social inequality and what are the obstacles to achievement, and try to build those into our filtering systems, whether they are admission systems or recruitment systems for jobs. I often like to point out that, you know, the reservation system is based on a sociological knowledge of the 1930s and 40s, 50 years ago and 100 years ago. It's also built on an administrative technology of the previous century. We need to now move far ahead of that. And it's a very nice point that you made by many people, Shivali, amongst several of you have pointed out this, that to think that we will create a meritocracy only by tweaking admissions is ridiculous. There are far greater problems, and beginning to acknowledge those and making those as part of creating a meritocracy is crucial. I had previous speakers ask very interestingly, why is it that those who say that merit is being destroyed, you know, by reservations don't want to do anything about the fact that schools don't function, that schools for the poor don't function? Is merit not being destroyed there? Perhaps far greater merit is being destroyed there. You know, why is it that they don't protest that at the fact that majority of the IIT students of higher level IITs end up going abroad? Is that not a destruction of merit? And perhaps at a far greater level of destruction of merit. So part of the rethinking of what is a meritocracy has to ask these questions, asking, what is the power structure? Why are certain things happening, certain things not happening? The expansion of educational facilities is one very important dimension. If we are having a society where, Shivali has talked, we have talked to you about this already, that if we are in, and my other, I don't see him now, the first speaker also talked about this, if we have a society where only there are a very few number of seats at the top, that itself is structuring opportunity in a particular way, and it's denying a great deal of opportunity to people who are highly talented. So to think about a meritocracy only in terms of admissions is far too restricted a way of thinking. It is a question of rethinking the opportunities of a society and rethinking the priorities of a society. Where are we investing? How are we cultivating people? Is our priority, and this is a very interesting ideological thing, that those who are at the points of privilege, they justify themselves as saying that I am meritorious, therefore I deserve everything. I would argue that this is actually not what the notion of merit means. The notion of merit is, how do we create openness in a society so that all kinds of abilities get encouragement and space? This is actually the reverse of the idea of merit, to say that I have a high scorer, therefore I deserve everything in a society, nobody else deserves it. This is not an open society. It's the opposite of an open society. It's missing the point altogether. So, let's